folks, and welcome to another edition of An Hour with Bob. And guess what? It's the first of the year. This is our first show in 2015. My God, 2015. That means we've been on the 23rd year on television. That's crazy. 2015. And right off the bat, folks, I want to talk about the Pawtucket Red Sox. I was just talking with someone prominent in the state of Rhode Island a little earlier today, and we're talking about the Red Sox, the Poor Sox, I should say, that it is real. That's what they're telling me, that it is real, that the Poor Sox are thinking about moving. They were bought up by the Boston Red Sox, and they're thinking about moving out of Pawtucket, and out of Rhode Island, period, which would be a real shame. And get this one, and I pointed something out to this person that they didn't realize, that one of the reasons why they're thinking of moving is because of the attendance. And they're basing their attendance on the year when the bridge was shut down or messed up there, when they were doing over the Route 95, the bridge to downtown, and they were doing over that exit, that very exit that goes to the ballpark. So in past years besides the year which was last year and the year before that they're mixing in, where they ranked seventh, all other years they ranked either one or two in the whole International League as far as attendance is concerned. It's like 8,500, 9,200, something like that, attendance every game, which is phenomenal for an International League baseball team. But when I hear the attendance ranking seventh in the league of 12, I think, and they're only at like 7,000, it's not accurate. So I hope that's not what they're basing it on. I hope they don't move. I hope they don't consider moving. It would be a huge downside for the state of Rhode Island and also, of course, for this city, the city of Pawtucket. And I want to say Happy New Year to everybody. It's been a while. We took a little hiatus. We ran some of our toys for tots. We do the four-hour telethon, as you know. December 9th, we did it this year, and it was a phenomenal success once again. And I'd like to thank my crew, Corey, Ryan, John. Who else was there? Who was that young lady that was there? Who?
Jessica.
Jessica Simpson, was she there?
Was
that who that was, Jessica? Yeah, and of course, Melissa and Marissa. And the singing was phenomenal, was it not, huh? Dominic and Marissa, of course, and who else? Who else? Samantha, the young girl, Samantha. Who else was singing? And
Nolan.
Of course, Nolan, he's 12 years old now. Can you imagine? We saw him the first time as a guitar player at 6. Now he's 12 years old. And we had a great time, and the biggest and the most important thing, folks, it was a huge success. Toys for Tots 2014. And of course, I want to thank all our big contributors, all our contributors, but especially the cellos people. They're phenomenal with us. And Iggy's Doughboys, they give away so much just to get toys. They give everybody, you go in there, you bring a toy, and you get a $10 item on their menu for a toy. All you got to do is guarantee the toy is at least worth $5, and you get a $10 worth of food for bringing in a toy. It cost them a lot of money, but they collected thousands of toys. They did a phenomenal job, as did Cellos, Mozzarella's. Who else? Who else is big with? Buffalo Wild Wings, too. And how about St. Germain, Mrs. St. Germain there? Laurie St. Germain?
Yeah.
Her son, who died in 2006, he was a Marine, unfortunately, and every year she's collected toys, and not only that, she runs car washes and all kinds of events, penny sales, cake sales, all kinds of stuff. Do you remember what the check was for she gave us, Corey? Ryan, do you remember? Besides all the toys, they brought like 8 boxes of toys. The check was for $3,150. That was phenomenal. Every year, the first year she came, 2006, was several months after her son had died. And she caught me way off guard when she told me how, I asked her why she was collecting these toys and doing it. She said, I do it for my son. And I said something, well, I was gonna say stupid, but there's no way of me knowing. I said, your son must be really, really proud of you. She goes, no, he's passed. He got killed in Iraq. I went, oh my God. And that year she collected $1,200, and every year it's gone up. And 2014, she collected $3,150 for the Toys for Tots. Lynn St. Germain. Well, let's get on with our show. Tonight we got a fun packed show. In fact, one of my guests is a return guest. We had him on the telethon, as a matter of fact, and he impressed everybody so much that night that I had to bring him back. Huh? Jason. You know Jason Morel, the magician who disappeared. He found his way back, though. He's back here tonight. We got him back. And we also have a group, or I can't call you a group, Mark. What do I call you? A business. Biome, what?
Biomes Marine Biology Center.
Marine Biology, and you're used when, oh, we got to get to you anyway. I'm going to get to you after. But it's a marine biology where you can bring your kids, and you can they have hands on. They can touch the crabs, and I don't know if you can touch the sharks. Can they touch the sharks? Kids can touch the sharks.
Oh,
too.
Yeah, you pet the sharks.
The little ones. How many kids lost their fingers so far?
No, none yet.
We're joking. No, these little sharks, you've got to see one in a little while with a baby, too, or
an egg.
An egg. Anyway, we'll talk to him because the first year I met him was the year Zachary, I think Zachary was 4 or 5 years old. We'll get to that, too. And also with me tonight, returning for fourth or five times. You've been on a few times there, Frank. How you doing, Frank? Happy New Year.
I'm chasing my buddy Gene, but I'm not going to be able to catch him.
Well, you may catch him if he doesn't come back on anymore, although he will. He will. Gene's a great guy. We're talking about Gene Valicenti, of course, and what we're talking about. Frank had asked me who holds the record for being on this show, and the answer is Gene Valicenti holds the record for being on the show. He's been on the show 12 or 13 times, and right behind him is who, guys? Anybody know? You know. Who? Tony Petracca. Corey got that one. Tony Petracca is number two. But you're getting up there, kid. You're doing well. And what's this? I see your work all over the place. I see your work with the Reds, the hockey. I see your work with the Pawtucket Red Sox. Over the years, your work's been all over Rhode Island. Actually, everybody knows your work. If they don't know.
The Paw Sox, that was my first poster.
Was it really?
Yep, 1999. Memories of McCoy.
Are you kidding me?
No.
I didn't know that when I said it, when I started rattling on about the Paw Sox, because that would be terrible if we lost the Paw Sox.
My first gig.
Do you know what was there before the Paw Sox? What team was there before the Paw Sox?
Something to do with the Indians.
It was the Indians. Right. Double A.
The Slaters or something?
It was the Cleveland Indians Double A team before the Red Sox.
I'm a sports cartoonist, I'm supposed to know this.
Well, no. Originally. No, it caught you off guard. How many years have they been there? Red Sox been there, what, 28 years now? Something like that. I think... I was going to say Mike Tamburo, but Ben Mondo would roll over in his grave if he ever heard that the Red Sox were going to move out of town, man.
He did a lot to keep that, yeah.
He sure did. Mm-hmm. He kept the prices down. He kept it great for a family. I mean, you can't go to a sporting event anywhere else other than McCoy Stadium that doesn't cost you a couple $100 to bring a family of 4 or 5 to a game. Mm-hmm. You know, it's still, you can go there for $40 or $50, including food.
Oh, yeah, easy.
Right? Because you can go there. I think the cheap tickets are only $4 or something like that. That'll never happen again now that the Red Sox own it.
They must have something in mind.
I think they do. I think what they have in mind is to build a facility like, and I've heard this, like they have at the stadium, at Gillette Stadium, like Gillette Patriot Place.
Right, yeah.
And around Boston. I think that's the idea. Well, that's one idea that you're hearing, one rumor that's going around, that they're going to move them close to Boston and turn it into this whole facility where they can make money doing stuff, other things, like the Patriots do.
Yeah, so they're all about making money.
Unfortunately, that's what it is. That's what's sad. That's what makes it so impossible to go. You can't go to, I've been a Baltimore Orioles fan. People know that. I've been a Baltimore Orioles fan since I was a kid because I always liked pitching and defense, and they, over the years, not so much recently, but years ago, they had the best pitching and the best defense. They always had 3 or 4 guys won Golden Gloves on the same team. They often, in fact, twice, they're the only team in Major League history to have 4 20-game winners on the same team, and they did it twice. Imagine having 4 20-game winners on your team.
I don't know if they remember that.
Yeah, twice they did it. 2 different years.
That was my second favorite team when I was growing up.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
And how many Golden Glovers? Paul Blair, the center fielder, was a Golden Glover. Brooks Robinson. I interviewed Brooks Robinson.
Really?
I interviewed Brooks Robinson, and I asked him, Mark, you might remember Brooks Robinson, huh? No? No?
No.
Uh-oh, he's too young to remember Brooks Robinson. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Anyway, Brooks Robinson, in my opinion, most people's opinion, is probably the greatest third baseman that ever lived defensively. Right?
Arguably, yeah.
In fact, the argument goes away when you say how many times he won the Golden Glove. 16 straight years he won the Golden Glove. The closest to him was Mike Schmidt, who won it 9 times, I believe. So 16 versus 9, you know?
Yeah.
Golden Glo- Schmidt hit more home runs than he did and might have had a higher batting average.
He just came out with a book or something, Smith.
Did he? Yeah, but he also, Brooks Robinson also had a phenomenal batting average in World Series, playoff and World Series competition. It was like 350. Anyway, I interviewed him and I said to him about this, about you're the greatest third baseman ever. He goes, oh, no, there's a lot of great ones. I go, how many Golden Gloves did you win? He goes, a very humble guy.
Yeah, most of those guys
16.
Were.
16. Well, the other guy wasn't. I also interviewed Frank Robinson.
Well, Frank's different.
He's a different, a little different. He's a different guy. He was my all-time favorite
guys.
Player, Frank Robinson.
Good guys.
And they had several players on that very same team. Five players on the same team had the Golden Gloves that year, or 1 year. Anyway, getting to you. Now, what do you make? What is this now? This is Rocky Point.
Well, actually, I've had that for about 16 years.
About the Rocky Point.
Yeah, that's based on my original poster, yeah.
It is.
But they called a couple of years ago, the Farrelly, not the Farrelly brothers, but one of their production guys in California.
Right.
Seemed like we like to use the image. They didn't tell me what it was going to be. And it ended up being in the movie.
And in the new movie.
I'm sorry, Dumb and Dumber 2, yeah.
Dumb and Dumber 2, T-O.
T-O.
Which is kind of confusing because they made a second Dumb and Dumber movie, but that was not with Jim Carrey and Jeff Daniels.
No, that's why I think they played with the words and put T-O.
Instead of T-W-O.
It's actually the third movie. And this is the card that got them on their journey to go find his long lost
daughter.
Really?
Yeah. What do you mean? They found this card? Explain it to me.
They find the card and he finds out he has a daughter somewhere and they go on this journey to find her. And Jim Carrey has a crush on her and all that kind of stuff. I don't want to spoil the movie.
Well, you can tell a little bit about it. But this started it? They saw this? They found this very card?
Yeah, and it's kind of funny because I think it was dated 1991 or something. But
right.
I actually drew it in 2000.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So this was
fun.
Now, you started this. You're a cartoonist mm-hmm. and an illustrator, right? Now, you started doing this when, Frank?
Well, news site I've been in 25 years.
Really?
Yeah, on the news, when I had newspapers. Remember those things, newspapers?
Well, the newspapers, they still make them? They still have newspapers?
A few of them.
Now, what did you work for? Who did you work for back in the day?
I was at the Journal, and I had 36 syndicated papers.
Really?
All over the country, yeah.
Wow.
I'm the most syndicated person to come out of Rhode Island. I don't think many Rhode Islanders know that. If it means anything at all.
Oh, you're the most syndicated?
Maybe the columnist.
Columnist
or cartoonist, yeah. It was kind of fun for a while.
Wow.
And then I got into this by default.
So now you make, you've
products
done.
Well, posters.
Well, that too, but I mean, you've done, we got that. We got to get a shot of this poster over here. Which one are we going to go
well,
to?
The
go
new
go
one is the Ocean State.
The Ocean State's in the middle. Get a shot of the Ocean State, will you? Now that's your Ocean State poster. That's your newest one, right?
Yes, it just came out for Christmas.
Yeah?
It did really good. And lots of nice people took part in that, as you can see, Wright's Farm and...
Now, I love, in fact, you know, it's funny, let's stop right there. Yeah. Wright's Farm. I have on my phone right now a text to Frank at Wright's Farm.
Do you?
That I'm sending him. I haven't sent it yet. I'm sending to Frank at Wright's Farm about doing a show that we did a show there before. I don't do very many on-location shows because it's a little more expensive to set up a show on mm-hmm. location. But we did a show there on location. I know John was there. Were you there, Corey? No, you weren't there. I know Ryan wasn't. If you weren't, Corey wasn't, Ryan wasn't. Because they're brothers. But we did a show there on location. We had a singer there. And then I went in the back and I cooked chickens. I cooked chickens. They have 75 ovens in that place. And they cook 16 chickens to each oven. And they start cooking 2.5 hours before they open because it takes 2.5 hours to cook a chicken. And they don't have a microwave in the place. Everything is cooked
oh, yeah.
to water. 2.5 hours to cook a chicken. So when they open up at, mm-hmm. I don't know, 11:30 in the morning, they're ready with the ovens. They start emptying the 75 ovens of 16 chickens each, do the numbers. And then they reload them and they do them for 2.5 hours more, and then they reload them again. They reload them 3 times.
The company that actually supplies them with chickens is on there as well.
The
Warwick Poultry.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And they supply them with
and
the chickens.
And the ice cream supplier is on there. Warwick Ice Cream.
Warwick Ice Cream. Warwick Poultry.
None of them knew they were each other was on it. That's kind of cool.
Wow.
Yeah, we have Yacht Club Soda on there, who this is going to be their 100th anniversary this year.
Yacht Club Soda's on Route 44.
Centerdale, the Scambato family.
Well, it's not actually Centerdale. It's right before Centerdale, isn't it? It's really on, Route 15? That's Route 15. Well, 15 and 44 where they meet, right? North Providence, anyway. Minnow Spring Avenue.
Monroe Dairy's on there.
What
They've
is
been
it?
Monroe Dairy. They've been out since 1886. So there's some really cool people on there. Yeah.
Well, how do you get them? How do you come up with these people?
We try to make a list of who, you know. This was big because of I had Rhode Island Icons for so many years and did well, and other businesses were asking me over the years. So I made a list of who didn't get on the first one. And I asked them if they could be on this one. And it went really well.
Oh, I remember the Bruins you did, the Reds. I mean, Rhode Island Reds.
That was an old one, too.
And then you did Bruins, too, right? Did you do the Bruins?
Yeah, 2011 Bruins.
Mm-hmm. And you did the Red Sox.
The three Red Sox.
Right. Right? The 70?
Three World Championships. No. 2004, 2007, and 13.
Championships,
Yeah.
I got a picture of me with the 75 Red Sox team.
That's a good team.
all the players that were available, I should say, at the time. I got. I didn't tell them.
Oh, I know which show you were talking about. Yeah.
Yeah.
The reunion.
With my good friend Joe Rocco.
I was just going to mention him.
You were?
Yeah, yes, I remember that show. Let me put that together. But aside from those,
what else you got? What is this?
Well, we have something really cool.
What is this?
If the state.
You're looking at this one?
Well, a little friend here, Rock and Roadie. He's been on the show before.
Yeah, he has now. Is that yours?
I'm trying to see if that's the book. Yeah, it is.
That's yours? Little, drew that?
Yeah, that's my real talent. When I was a kid, I started out with the cartoons. I wanted to be like Walt Disney. So this is going to hopefully be the state mascot.
Why shouldn't it be? Of course it should be. We'll get a shot at it.
We're going to have them do like promotions and welcome the people to the state and do things with the kids.
Now, what do we got to do to get him to be a state mascot?
What is
the state mascot now?
No, there isn't.
There's no state mascot? No,
he's the state bird. You know, the Red Island Red is
the state
bird. They vote on it.
Oh, and the state does. That could take months.
My friend Nick Mattiello, the new speaker, hopefully he can help me.
Oh, good. Well, you got a friend in there, especially the Speaker of the House now. Hey, Nicky, where are we? Hey, Nick, come on. State mascot. What's the alternative?
No, he's already out in the public. We're trying to get him to be the official state mascot.
Oh, somebody
take
has
to the next level.
But he'll have to have one of the reps.
But in Rhode Island, that's right.
It has to bill first. He wouldn't do it. He would have one of his underlings do it.
Right. You do the bill, and then they vote on it, and things like this have been done. That's why we have an official soda. We have official coffee, milk, drink.
Well, yeah, whatever. And then they didn't do something about calamari. Did that happen?
Official appetizer. Yeah.
Did that happen? Calamari?
Oh, yeah.
That one? It took them, they were nights, 3 in the morning trying to decide on that one.
Yeah, we didn't vote on getting to get jobs or anything.
No. You vote on calamari. I mean, that's ridiculous. Hey, you're not helping yourself there, buddy.
I know enough of those guys. So that's what we have.
Hey, Nick, he's only kidding. Nicky, he's only kidding. We still want this to happen.
Well, Nick didn't have it in the spirit. He wasn't speaking.
Oh, he wasn't there. No, he wasn't speaking then, right?
Someone else was there.
Somebody might be going to jail.
Someone that's not there anymore.
Yeah, he's not there anymore. Yeah, the fox in the hen house types of thing?
Yeah, something like that.
The fox in the hen house.
So now we got to switch gears.
So now, what are you doing now? You were just at the Warwick Mall doing this, right? You were at the mall?
I'm there every day through the holidays. That's why I saw you, but I didn't want to bother you.
Why not?
Because there was a lot of setting up going on, and I saw you were talking to some people. Something was happening there.
Well, we're getting ready to do the telethon, apparently.
So I just
It had to be close to 5 o'clock, right?
Yeah.
It had to be very close to 5
A lot of equipment there. You guys bring a lot of stuff there.
We do. That's why when we do a show on location, it's costly. So it's not like you're doing something in the studio where the equipment is already here. We got to transport all the equipment down there. We did have a lot of equipment there.
Maybe we can get the magician to make this somehow magically become the mascot.
Oh, there you go. How do you like that? Is that a big one for you, Jason?
Do a kai trick or something like that. We got to get to him, so.
Yeah?
Yeah.
All right.
Don't waste time on me. Let's get
All right, you want to get to him?
You can get back to me.
All right, you want to hang in? You want to hang out for a while?
Oh, yeah, I'm not going anywhere.
Okay, all right. Well, look, we're going to go to a clip, and we're going to come back. I think we're going to come back. We're going to do a quick... You got a couple of tricks for me, right? Three? All right, here's what we're going to do. We're going to come back with a trick, and then I'm going to see my good friend over there, Mark. All right? All right, so give us a clip. We'll be right back on an hour with Bob, folks. Stay with us.
But sources of water, like rainfall, rivers, streams, reservoirs, certainly haven't doubled. So where is all that extra water coming from? More and more, it's being pumped out of the ground. Water experts say groundwater is like a savings account, something you draw on in times of need. But savings accounts need to be replenished. And there is new evidence that so much water is being taken out, much of the world is in danger of a groundwater overdraft. California is entering its fourth year of a record-breaking drought. Last year was the driest since the state started keeping records more than 100 years ago. And yet, pay a visit to California's Central Valley, and out of that parched land, you'll see acre upon acre of corn, almond trees, pomegranates, tomatoes, grapes, and what makes them all possible, water. Where do you get water in a drought? You take it out of the savings account. Groundwater.
We're talking about surface water, we're talking about lakes and rivers, okay? When we're talking about groundwater, we're really talking about water below the water table.
Jay Famiglietti, an earth sciences professor at the University of California, Irvine, is a leading expert on groundwater.
It's like a sponge. It's like an underground sponge.
He's talking about the aquifers where groundwater is stored. Layers of soil and rock, as he showed us in this simple graphic, that are saturated with water and can be drilled into, like the three wells shown here.
You can actually pump it out of the crevices.
Imagine like trying to put a straw into a sponge. You can actually suck water out of a, right, out of a sponge. It's a very similar process.
Sucking the water out of those aquifers is big business these days in the Central Valley. Well driller Steve Arthur is a very busy man.
All the farmers, they don't have no surface water. They've got to keep these crops alive. The only way to do that is to drill wells, pump the water from the ground.
So it's either drill or go out of business.
Yes.
Hey, we're back. We're back with Jason Morel. Jason was on our Toys for Tots telethon. And he did such a good job, I invited him back. How you doing, Jason?
Excellent.
Nice to see you.
Great to see you.
Oh, you even get sound in the studio, huh?
Oh,
what's
well, I'm
with
gonna...
that? You gotta be a, you gotta have a lot of pull to get that off. I can't even get sound in the studio. What are you doing for us here?
Well, if you'll step back for one moment, Bob, because you are not gonna believe what you are about to see.
Oh, I like hearing that. Or maybe I don't. Go ahead.
To my fellow viewers, what you're seeing is real. Nothing is staged. So, without further ado, Maestro, if you please.
Turn him down.
Magic is about illusion. It's about trick of the eye. Now, don't blink for a half a second, or you're going to miss something absolutely amazing. Magic. This is the lovely Disney.
Wow, very good. You've been trapped for how many years? Well, that was pretty neat.
Thank you. That was
pretty good.
Thank you.
Wow, impressive. Well, we're going to be back with you again. You got another trick or two up your sleeve?
Absolutely.
Is she included?
Absolutely.
Okay. I'm going to see you a little later, all right? All right, good. All right, we'll be back. Give us a clip. We'll be right back on an hour with Bob after more of your water problem.
And just water, one month.
Right now, we're reaching water levels that are at historic lows.
Historic lows.
Right. At this site, water levels have dropped about 200 feet in the last few years.
Gathering data from holes in the ground like this has been the only way to get a handle on groundwater depletion. That is, until 2002, and the launch of an experimental NASA satellite called GRACE.
What does GRACE stand for?
So GRACE stands for Gravity Recovery and Climate Experiment.
Mike Watkins is head of the science division at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena. He was the mission manager for the latest Mars rover mission, and he is the project scientist for GRACE.
So the way GRACE works is it's two satellites.
Two?
They're actually measuring each other's orbit very, very accurately.
What affects that orbit is gravity.
As the first one comes up on some extra mass, an area of higher gravity, it gets pulled away from the second spacecraft.
And that's where water comes in. Since water has mass, it affects the pull of gravity. So after the first GRACE satellite approaches an area that's had lots of heavy rain, for example, and is pulled ahead, the second one gets there, feels the pull, and catches up. The instruments are constantly measuring the distance between the two.
Their changes in separation, their changes in their orbit, are a little different this month than last month because water moved around and it changed the gravity field just enough.
So GRACE can tell whether an area has gained water weight or lost it.
So GRACE is like a big scale in the sky.
Absolutely.
GRACE can also tell how much water an area has gained or lost.
We're back on an hour with Bob. How'd you like that trick, folks? Hey, how'd you like that trick, Mark?
I thought it was pretty impressive.
Wasn't it pretty good?
It was very.
Wow. Mark and Renee DiPippo, right?
You got it.
And Mark Hull? Hall. Mark Hall.
Yep.
Now, what is this? How do you say it?
Biomes. It's my marine biology center. It's basically an education center that's in North Kingstown.
And now when we started to talk about it off camera, you were at a disadvantage because I was talking to Steve. Right. You couldn't talk, or you didn't talk about how we met initially. That was, what'd you say?
I think that was 95, you and Zach came.
Wow.
Came by, I think you just stumbled on
my place.
And that was my old, very small place.
Yeah,
facility.
That was out in the, I don't even know how I found it.
And
I was extremely impressed, though.
And right. I think I hadn't been open more than a year when you guys stumbled in there.
Really?
So that was 95. Yeah, so 20 years we've been doing
this. Wow.
Yeah.
Now I take my nephew, his son, over there to your place, the new place, which is eight times the size.
We went from 2,000 square feet to about 12,000 square feet of exhibits, of floor space. And we do a little bit with reptiles, but we focus mainly on the local marine life that we have. We actually have the largest collection of New England animals in the world.
Really?
Yeah.
And what's impressive is what I really liked, it's hands-on. Like, kids can go in there, they can touch a crab, they can touch things.
Pet
without
the sharks.
Getting yelled at. Pet shark. Now there's your pet shark, right?
Yeah, we'll talk about him in a minute, but we've got two types of sharks. I brought one of them with me.
So
we try to do as much hands-on as we can. We get little tide pools for the kids with crabs and sea urchins and starfish. We have a stingray that the kids can pet. So it's a lot of hands-on.
But by the way, you didn't mention where you are. I know you're right on Route 1 and Post Road in North Kingstown.
We're
right
on Post Road in North Kingstown, just north of Quonset Point.
Just north of Quonset Point, just south of East Greenwich.
Right.
Just over the line into North Kingstown.
Yeah, maybe a half a mile from the East Greenwich line.
Yeah, and like you said, 12,000.
It was the old Gable House furniture store.
I knew it was a furniture store. I was going to say that. It was a furniture store. Do you know that, Renee?
I did know that.
You do? Of course you knew that. Anyway, I am amazed. Oh, I know what I got to ask. I say to you first. How's that? What do you have? That giant, is it a grouper there that you actually?
Oh, Earl, yeah.
he has a fish in there that he can actually, it follows him around. Huh?
Yeah, I've had him since he was about an inch. He's 25 pounds now, and he'll pick me out of a crowd, follow me around.
That is funny. Yeah. Well, he literally doesn't follow him around. He doesn't have legs or nothing, folks. I mean, he follows. He's in a big tank, and he moves around when he moves around in the building. It's pretty cool. It's pretty interesting.
One of my favorites.
Yeah, I'll bet. Yeah. I'll bet. Now, what did you want to start with first? Now, these are some of the items that kids can see, kids can handle, everything can they handle. Obviously, they can't handle those things,
Yeah, we've
right?
got two animals that they can handle, and we've got two that are on display and exhibit. Renee can talk about the first two. This is
now this is always when I was a kid, even way back in the day. Mm-hmm. We used to seahorses uh-huh. were unique in the fact that the males carry the babies.
Yeah, that's true.
Why don't they just call them a female because they're carrying the baby?
I don't know.
Well, it's because
I've never had that question before, so I can't really answer it.
The females actually still produce the eggs, but they lay the eggs into the pouch of the male. So a female still produces the eggs.
Oh, the female produces the eggs?
Yeah. All the male's doing is carrying them.
Okay. So it's like a kangaroo with the pouch.
Yeah, except the female kangaroo still carries the baby.
Oh, all right. So in this case, it's the male that carries
Joey.
It.
Joey. You know, it's a Joey.
But they look like horses. They actually look like horses. And you said there's a male and a female in there?
There is. Mm-hmm.
Can I ask a silly question? How do you know which is which?
The male has the brew pouch, so it's kind of smoother looking.
Oh, okay.
And a little fluffy sometimes, and the female doesn't have that.
I don't have a brew pouch.
Well, you're not a seahorse.
People might think I have a pouch.
Is that the male?
That's
moving?
That's the male.
That's the male moving?
Yeah, that just went swimming by.
And they got that tail. They use the tail a lot, like to curl around things like he's doing right now?
Yep, they use it to hook onto eelgrass and seaweed.
Look how cool that is, huh? And the kid, did the kids get a big kick out of these? Is this one of the more popular items?
Oh, they love them.
Yeah, I would think
so.
And
we breed them there. We raised some last year. So we had over 400 babies last year. And we released them back into the bay.
Oh, isn't that cool? Now, do you see them here? I mean,
we do. These are local. They're not real common, but they are found here all year round.
Really? Yeah. I mean, I've been a fisherman all my life. I've always gone down the bay to do fishing, and I think I've seen them once or twice, but I don't see them.
Yeah, they're very secretive. You don't see a lot of them.
No.
And then a lot of the animals that we have at Biomes, they're tropical-looking fish, and you saw like Earl, the grouper.
Right.
And those are fish that, when they're babies, they come up on the Gulf Stream current. And they find their way here in the summer.
And then they take off. Here.
No, they all die.
Oh, they do?
Yeah, they all die because they're not migrating. So uh-huh. they don't know they're lost. They get here and they live here until it gets too cold and then they all die.
Oh.
Next year, all new ones come up.
Oh, wow.
But we save as many as we can and grow them out.
And how about?
Like Earl, this big.
Yeah, I know. Earl, folks, Earl is, what'd you say, 25 pounds?
It's 25 pounds, yeah.
That's amazing. I'd like to catch him. Now, this right here, a horseshoe crab, when I was growing up, we used to think that these things are stingers. We were told as kids these things were stingers.
Yeah, no, these are completely harmless.
And this thing is actually used to flip them back over.
If they get turned upside down.
And I do know that that's the female. The female is bigger than the male.
Female's bigger than the male.
A lot bigger than the male.
Yeah, but even when they're smaller, you can tell the difference. So here's the...
Well, you want me to say what I said? How you can tell the difference between a male and a female?
No, you're not. Nope.
Unless you want to hear it from
me. No, go ahead, go ahead.
All right, so...
And I see these down in East Greenwich. I see them going down there and harvesting them, taking them. They come on the shore at the new moon or the full moon.
First full moon in the spring.
And loads of them, tons of them, they come right up on the shore, right down at the dock there in East Greenwich, the town dock. They're all over the shore.
Yeah, and they use some for...
They draw blood from them.
They do. Some are used for bait for eel traps, which I'm not a big fan of. But others are drawn. They draw the blood, and they use the blood to test the purity of intravenous drugs.
Wow! But they do release them.
They do. In that case, they do release them.
Right. So they live after that. Right.
Yep.
But at first, I thought when I saw them taking them, I said, "Oh, what are you doing with all them? They're just scooping them up because it's easy to take and easy to catch. Because when they're on shore, they don't even move. They think they're hiding." Yeah. And one thing I found interesting, you said they have how many eyes? How many eyes? Is there there's an argument over here on how many eyes?
Between 8 to 10 eyes.
Between 8 to 10, so 9.
Could be 9
eyes. And this is an eye right here too.
Yeah, these two right here are the compound eyes. These are like what?
Can we pick this up? Or you want to pick this up? Go ahead.
These two right here are our eyes. There's two very, very small dots. Those can't see anything.
See that, Frank?
Oh yeah.
They got two eyes right in the front.
And those are light sensitive eyes. They just tell the difference, difference between dark and light.
And this is the one that tells them when the moon's out?
Yeah, there's one eye, and I don't know if you, some people won't really refer to it as an eye, but there's a structure there that can tell the phases of the moon.
That's unbelievable. And these are eyes too, right?
And these are the compound eyes that I was telling you.
Wow. Oh, go ahead. You got to pick
them
up.
Well, you were asking about the male and the female. So if you turn them over, you can see that all of the, and again, these are completely harmless. You put your hand right in there.
Really?
Yeah, just put your hand right in. Let him grab you.
No, I ain't let him grab me.
Just like this. Okay? And you can see all the pinches on the legs. With the female.
Look at all these. Don't these pinch these things right here?
No, see, go ahead. Come on, you got to do that.
All right, good.
Oh, don't give me that.
I'm joking, folks. I'm joking.
So these, if you look at the first set of legs, see how that, as a pincher, looks just like the other legs.
Right.
That's the female. If it's a male, we didn't bring a male, but if it's a male, it looks like this boxing glove. Two of them.
Oh, the first two?
On the first two, right. So these, if it was a male, these two right here would have these little hooks.
Oh, I get you. And that's the only difference. And this is used to flip them back over because he would die or she would die.
And we actually have some, and we actually...
I saw that. Yeah. I saw that. They actually put prosthetics because this thing was busted off.
Yeah, and some of my volunteers will go out and they'll try to find the ones without the tail. What happens is a boat propeller will chop it off once in a while.
Uh-huh.
Just by accident. And once the tail's gone, they can't turn themselves
and
over.
And I actually saw that and I said, oh my God. Mark's putting artificial tails on him because without the tail, he's going to die or she's going to die. And because when they get on the shore, if they're flipped over like that, they end up using using this to flip them, to right themselves.
Or in the water, even in the water.
Or in the water,
yeah. These flaps down here, these are the gills. So that's how they breathe in.
Oh, wow.
And what's really cool is these, if you look at the last pair of legs, see they're a little different, kind of spread out.
Yeah.
They use those for two things. One is to push off of, so that that gives them the strength to really go when they need to.
But and they also, really move them too. I mean, they really work them.
You notice there's something different on this one, right? These little flaps, and there's this long one.
Right.
This is real.
That's like his thumb?
Nope. That's this is actually used to clean the surface dirt and stuff off the gills. They use it like a windshield wiper.
Wow.
So it'll go and they'll wipe that off. It's important to keep those things clean so they can breathe.
They can breathe. Well, not only that, so they can close and open, right?
Right. I love stuff like this. I love structures that have very, very specific purposes. And here's a structure that all it's used for is to clean the gills.
That's pretty amazing. And they know, look, they know that I'm here, look.
Oh, yeah. And there's the mouth right there, right in the middle. So where all those spines are.
Yeah.
So it works sort of like a ratchet as they move their legs. All those little spines push the food down into the mouth. Here's the stomach right here.
That's the stomach?
So the stomach's in the front of the mouth.
Wow.
Instead of behind like every
right,
other.
Right, right,
right. Let me turn it back.
Pretty cool. And to think, we're always afraid of these things as kids.
Completely harmless.
Because they look, I mean, they're very intimidating. All right, what else you got here?
All right, here we've got one of the two sharks that I
mentioned. The sharks you talked about?
This is called a chain cat shark. The other sharks
chain?
Chain cat shark. Right?
Chain cat shark? Yeah. Oh, because it looks like a chain?
Chain link fence.
Right.
All the way around. This is a female. These are the small ones we get. They don't get more than about 2 feet.
And it takes, what, 6 or 8 years to get
1 foot? Yeah, these are about 8 years old. Most of the ones that we have, we actually hatched 8 years ago when they were babies. We hatched
Which
them.
Is?
There's the egg right here.
That's an egg.
And this is her egg. And she's actually pregnant with another one. You can see how.
Now, when did this egg come out?
About 3 weeks ago. And it'll take several months for that to hatch.
Several months.
Yeah. So that's actually the egg. So she produces that. It just lies on the bottom. She swims away, never deals with it again, and then eventually it'll hatch.
Now tell me, if there's more than one shark in the same tank, do they bother other sharks, bother the other eggs?
No, they just ignore all the eggs.
Really?
Yeah.
Even if they're hungry?
And what we do is we take the eggs out, we put them in a hatching tank so that they stay safe.
You know, right, because they would eat it if they were hungry. They'd eat
well,
it, right?
It's mostly because these are in one of our touch tanks, so the kids are able to pet
these. Oh, right,
these.
Right, right. They might.
And so we don't want anybody picking this up and squeezing it, not knowing what it is. So
right.
We put them all aside. But then our second type of shark, we have dogfish sharks, and that's the main attraction as far as petting. And they're anywhere from two to three.
Come
or four
on,
feet,
and know. The kids can pet them.
Oh yeah, they come right up and you can pet
because
them.
Because they're not dangerous.
No, completely harmless.
Really. Yep. How many varieties of shark are there? 200 and something?
No, close to 300.
Yeah.
Yep. Most of them are tropical. We don't have a whole lot around here. But These are, most people have never seen these before. They are local, but they're very deep water.
That's a local shark?
There's a local, yeah.
Really?
Like I said, everything that we do pretty much is local animals. But these are real deep water. You're not gonna go fishing and find these.
Right. Well, that's pretty cool. Now you have how many different kind of marine animals you have down there?
Roughly 110, 120
yeah,
species.
Over 100 for sure. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
It must be a lot of work to maintain.
We have some.
These are all salt water, right? Or most of them?
These are all salt water.
Is it everything salt water there, or most of it?
Almost everything. We have some specialty exhibits, turtle tanks, things like that.
But you got to keep the salt water. How do you keep the salt water?
A lot of volunteers that work very hard.
Yeah.
We have a lot of volunteers that are great. They spend a lot of time doing water testing and changing water and.
Now, what do you got to do? Go get. A big tank full of water.
No,
we make it back.
We make it all.
You make
all,
your own yeah, salt
make,
water.
Yeah, we make all the salt water ourselves. It's artificial salt water. It's called Instant Ocean. Just add water.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, cause I, silly me. I thought you'd go get a big tanker and go pump water out of the ocean, bring it back. You could do that, right?
We could, but that would be more work than making it yourself.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That would be harder.
Plus, we know there's no pollution in it.
This is true. So, when are you open down there?
We're open 7 days a week. Mornings we dedicate to school field trips and birthday parties on the weekends.
That's great too.
We also do a lot of outreach. That's what Renee's in charge of. She does
the schools and stuff.
Yeah, she coordinates all the outreach to the schools, and we bring the live animals to the schools. That's actually how I started this 30 years ago.
Oh, did you really?
Yeah,
25 years ago. That's amazing.
And then. Every day we open, after we finish all of our morning programs, we open at noon to the public where anybody can come in, and that's from noon to 5 every day.
Okay.
And then we have special events at night. We've got a Girl Scout overnight coming up.
Really? You're going to stay in there overnight?
Yeah, we did one a couple months ago.
That's cool.
Yeah, it was
that's
a big
cool
hit.
For the kids.
Yeah.
Well, maybe there'll be a lot more people interested in that after they see this show.
Hope so.
You can do it overnight. Yeah. Right on Route 1. In North Kingston, what's the number of North Kingston?
6640.
6640, North Kingston, Post Road, North Kingston. It's weird because in East Greenwich, it's called Main Street. As soon as it hits North Kingston, it reverts back to Post Road.
Yeah.
Warwick, it's Post Road. East Greenwich, it's Main Street. And then North Kingston becomes Post Road again. Well, thank you, Mark. Thank you for stopping by. Huh? Oh, I'm sorry. I forgot about him. What'd you do? You made a quick change. That wasn't there when I was looking. What happened there? All right, go ahead. I'm embarrassed now because I didn't see the puffer fish. What happened there?
All right, so this is this is one of our puffer fish. We catch them. They're little tiny things, about that big. We keep them for 3 years. So on the third year, this is a three-year-old puffer fish. We use them for our demonstrations. We bring them out.
Now
to
you
schools.
Can touch him.
This wouldn't be in a touch tank. They'll give you a good bite.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Check, see.
Yeah, that's
go ahead.
And then after the third year, after we've used them for all of the demonstrations, then we release them back into the bag.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. So do you want to
see a puffer? Yeah, I want to see them puff up.
Yeah, they puff up.
When they get agitated?
There's a misconception that they puff up when they're scared or to try to scare another animal. They actually do it so that they don't get swallowed. They do it only if another animal grabs it.
Uh-huh.
So to show you how, and this doesn't hurt, it's completely harmless. They do this almost every day. So I do it very gently, and I can just pick them up, and then I tickle his belly. See how gentle I'm doing it? See, very, very gently. Doesn't hurt him at all. And then he puffs up. So now you're not gonna be able to swallow it.
Whoa.
If I hold him gently, and he spits all the water back out, goes right back to the
water. That was water, not air.
No, they can do air or water, but I was holding it underwater, so it was doing the water.
Oh, that's weird. But you're right. Everybody thinks that it's because they're afraid, but it's not. They're actually afraid of being swallowed. So it is a fear factor. Huh, Puffer? Well, that's pretty cool. And you show kids this, huh, when they come in?
Oh, this is, we've got a whole bunch of these, and they take turns doing the demonstrations. So we have, we do them during birthday parties. Renee takes them out to the schools. We do them for the public when they come in. We have scheduled times. We do different demonstrations. So at different, every half hour we do a different demonstration. We feed the octopus. We've got octopuses
that
open jars. Remember that?
Yes.
I think you saw that.
Yes.
And then we feed the sharks at a certain time. And so we have demonstrations that we do for the public at different times of the day.
And they can go on your website and see all
this
stuff,
too. You
can
go on the website, and there's a schedule there of when we do the demonstrations.
And the website is?
www.biomecenter.com.
Okay, there you go. Yeah. All right, well, thank you guys for stopping by.
All right.
You got to hang around. We got a couple more tricks to be going, all right, Renee?
Sounds good.
Maybe we'll make you appear over there or something. All right, give me a clip, and we'll be right back on An Hour with Bob. I hope you're enjoying the show, folks.
Time-lapse animation of the changes Grace detected there over the last 12 years. Note the dates on the... The redder it gets, the greater the loss of water.
Oh, look at that.
He calculated that more than half the loss was due to groundwater depletion.
And this is a huge agricultural region.
Have they been doing the same kind of pumping that we're seeing
yes,
in California?
Yes.
It got so dark red.
Yeah, that's bad.
His India findings were published in the journal Nature. But as he showed us, India wasn't the only red spot on the Grace map.
So this is right outside Beijing, Bangladesh, and then across southern Asia.
He noticed a pattern.
They are almost exclusively located over the major aquifers of the world, and those are also our big food-producing regions. So we're talking about groundwater depletion in the aquifers that supply irrigation water to grow the world's food.
If that isn't worrisome enough, some of those aquifer systems are in volatile regions. For instance,
and that with Jason Morel here on An Hour with Bob. Magic.
Maestro, if you please.
Oh my gosh. Technical difficulty?
A sleight of hand is the most difficult yet fascinating type of magic to be performed on stage. But once perfected, it is the most mystifying. One magician, two hands, and a few surprises. Watch closely. The doves are kind of camera shy. You gotta pretty up the cage. One, two. You.
Wow, very good.
Thank you very much.
Wow, how cool is that, Jason?
Thank you.
Now, I told you were going to cook the birds there. What are you doing this to the birds? Now, I think we got time for, do we have time for one more trick, do we? Do we have time for one more trick? You got another trick for me?
Yes, I do.
You do?
Yes, I do. And Maestro even knows the music.
You think he's going to get it this time?
Well, let's see.
Let's see. You want music, Maestro.
Bob, for my last trick, I have something very special
Want
to show you. Yes. Miss Isabel is going to come forward.
Miss Isabel.
Now, if you could inspect her real quick. Make sure
inspect her?
Make sure her body is intact.
What the?
Do a little dance.
Do a pirouette. Okay, she's intact.
Now remember, what you're going to see is real. It's not gimmicked, it's not staged.
It's not edited?
It's not edited.
It's as it happens.
But it is an illusion. Maestro, if you please, I'm going to attempt to take the lovely Miss Isabel and twist her body.
Twist her body.
Remember, it's only an illusion. Got to tighten up the head.
Oh, no! Tighten up the head.
You okay? Great. Time to twist her around. Say goodbye-bye to Isabel.
Bye-bye, Isabel.
Let's twist again. And again. And one more time.
She's still there.
Yes, she is.
You gotta turn the other way, yeah, yeah. Whoa! Your head's all right? Your neck's all right? That's gotta be tough on the neck, though, isn't it?
I'm not the one that gets in the box.
How's your neck?
A little sore.
A little sore? Your neck's a little sore? That was very good, Jason.
Thank you.
Now, as we know, as I know anyway, maybe some of the people that didn't see the Toys for Tots telethon don't know that you started magic in a strange way, or a different way anyway.
I started magic on August 17th, 1980. I was sitting in the basement of my parents' house. This is when I was a short, knee to a high to a grasshopper. And I was watching TV, and long story short, I was to the left, my mom was to the right, my dad was in the middle. And they just started
disappeared?
Well, my father flipped through the television channels, and he said, Jason, look who that is. And I said, Mommy, who's that? That's cool. He's like, that's Mr. David Copperfield. He's a magic guy.
All right, right.
And I said, can I be a magic guy when I grow up? And they said, we'll see if you get good grades first.
But what I was alluding to was you went in the service,
yep.
You were in the Army.
And the military spent my GI Bill to send me to Magic College.
Which I had never heard of before. Where's the Magic College? I believe you. Now, where's the Magic
it's
College?
It's actually the Academy of Magical Arts.
In California, right?
Hollywood, California,
Hollywood,
yes.
California. And how long of a college is that?
6 months.
Is it really, yeah?
It's a challenge.
I'll bet it's got to be pretty interesting, though, to go to a college like that.
I specialize in card effects. If I had a deck of cards right now, I could show you something that would absolutely baffle you.
Really? Well, maybe next time we'll have to do that.
Maybe.
In fact, by the way, I've seen David Copperfield twice in person. And I've also, this month coming up, they have the Illusionist at PPAC, right? The 16th to the 18th, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the dates?
Yes, sir.
And I plan on going to that. Are you going to go to that?
Yes, I am.
Yeah, I want to be there. Well, thank you, Jason. Thank you for stopping by.
It's always an honor. Thank you.
And thank you. Nice to see you. The lovely?
Miss Isabel.
Miss Isabel. Last name. No last name?
She hasn't told me yet.
It's
George. Isabella George.
Isabella George. Isabel. Well, thank you, Isabella George. Take care of that neck. All right, let me go back over here, my good friend Frank, and ask Frank what he thought about that whole magic thing.
That was pretty cool.
Wasn't that nice? Mark, what'd you think?
I got it from a different perspective here. That's pretty cool.
Wasn't it different, huh?
Very nice.
Well, yeah, you got a different perspective.
I got it right up close.
But did you figure it out?
No. I tried it. I'm a Houdini, what do you call that? We have an interest in things?
Yeah.
I'm big on Houdini. And I was trying to figure it out. I couldn't figure it out.
Yeah. I love magic. I always did. Always love magic. And do you have the Illusionist coming to PPAC on the 16th to the 18th of January? And I expect to be going to one of those shows. I probably won't go to the first one because you'd expect that to be the busier one.
Yep. Hope we get down there.
Yeah. And I've seen... Anytime I see a magician, I want to see what they do because it's pretty cool to see what they do. Is he making me disappear or something? What is he doing?
I thought he was.
I got to be careful with him behind me, you know. So what's your next project?
We have Block Island coming up this summer.
Block Island.
I have a new Rocky Point piece coming out. A whole new...
Oh, yeah, they opened that up again, right?
Yeah, Rocky we had Point. A fun day. That's actually what inspired me doing a second one. And a few more...
I'm glad they saved some of that land.
Oh, it's really beautiful. Yes. It actually is, so we'll see.
Yeah, that's
lots of things coming.
That's a beautiful place. Rocky Point is really, really...
And they can find me on frankgalasso.com.
frankgalasso.com. frankgalasso.com, right?
That's right. And everybody gets a free Rocky Point card today. How's that?
Oh, you got Rocky Point cards. I want this one. I want this one, too. This is a good one right here. I like this. I actually like this.
He was a pretty good hit during the holidays. We kind of just put him out there as like a teaser.
See yeah.
What kind of reaction.
You're going to get well. Stuffed animals made like him, too. You'll be hustling them down at the Warwick Ball, right? Next time.
On display, yeah.
On display at the Warwick Ball.
And we'll get our friends to do some tricks with him, how's that?
Yeah, we're going to have you back, Jason. I want to see that other trick. All right? Soon enough, we'll have you back. And we've got to get on and see Mark and Renee down in North Kingstown, Rhode Island. Right? 7 days a week, huh?
7 days a week.
7 days a week. You can come down and see them noon to five?
Noon to five to the public.
Noon to five to
everything
the public.
Everything else is by appointment.
And exactly. So schools that want
schools, birthday parties, scout programs, those are all by scheduled. And then 12 to 5 every day, anybody can come in.
Wow, that's cool. That is a cool place. That really is. And it's funny how I found that place, just purely by accident with Zachary. When I didn't realize he was so young at the time.
Yeah, I think he was about four.
4 years old at the time. That's unbelievable. Hey, folks, on next show, we have a good friend. Hasn't been on a while, but he's been on several times. And he was there for us for Toys for Tots. John DeLuca is coming on the show with his co-host, Alexandria, right? Alexandria, what's your last name? Colin, is that her name? Crowley. Alexandria Crowley, that's her name. Collins, I was thinking Collins. Alexandria Crowley is coming on. She's absolutely beautiful. And she's our... Well, those two are our couple guests next show. And we have a musical guest on that show. And we also have another guest on that show, but I'm not going to tell you yet. So we'll see you in 2 weeks from tonight here on An Hour with Bob. And folks, if you want to take part in the production of, because I'm asked this all the time, you want to take part in the production of An Hour with Bob, we shoot the show on Monday evenings. We go on the air, we tape at 7:30 at night, but the crew usually gets here, hopefully, at 6 o'clock. And we're done at 9:30. By the time we clean up, we know we usually go get something to eat or some appetizers or whatever. But it's a Monday night, every other Monday night. And if you want to take part, if you're going to college and you're majoring in communication or you're majoring in something to do with media, get a hold of us, get a hold of me. Bob@bobsadventures.com is my email address, or vetbob@gmail.com is my other email address, or bobsadventures.com is another way to get a hold of me, or even on Facebook, and you can be one of the crew members on An Hour with Bob here in Pawtucket at the old cable studio at 670 Narragansett Park Drive in Pawtucket, and you can have some fun. You can learn something. And if you're taking up that stuff, you'll learn a lot more. People tell us all the time, they learn a lot more here, hands-on, than they do in a classroom. So it's a good way to supplement your college education. And it doesn't cost you nothing. We have fun. You don't get paid. We have fun. I got two kids here that have been...
Paid?
You don't get paid. Oh, I'm still holding your check, right? You've been here how many years, Corey? 10? 11. 11. And you've been here what? Same, 10 years, 11 years? All right. Well, folks, thank you for spending an hour with Bob. And thank